Coventry, almost the smelliest city. After having seven shades knocked out of it in 1940, Coventry is back and looks forward to a bright new future. Of concrete, car parks, friendly shopkeeps selling the finest tobacco, more concrete, butchers selling the finest sweetmeats, cobblers who can also cut you a set of keys for some reason, a bloody huge IKEA, and not one, not two, not three, but four Wetherspoons, all serving decent ale at reasonable prices to keep its citizens' bladders well stocked for preserving the tradition of a city always smelling faintly of urine. And there's much more besides that! The city has a proud medieval history, and not just that time when the wife of the Saxon Earl Leofric rose around in the nip for no good reason. Slow down, chaps. You'd think the Midlands had never seen a naked lady on a horse before. But Coventry was also home to a once mighty cathedral that no longer exists. Oh, no, not that one. Everybody knows about that cathedral. Oh, I forgot to keep doing the voice. Didn't people in the old days speak over footage in a weirdly mannered fashion? Haha. Anyway, hey guys, I'm back. What's up? Today we're going to be looking for something very cool. Coventry's missing cathedral. But first, don't forget to like, subscribe, hit that bell, sign my guestbook, and solve my maze. The story of Coventry's missing cathedral starts with the Normans, who shortly after the conquest messed around with the Anglo-Saxon diocese, including moving the seat of the bishop from the hick-swamp town of Lichfield to the fortified Roman town of Chester, starting the Church of St John there as their new cathedral. Chester only lasted 27 years before the seat was moved to Coventry and the Priory of St Mary, which had been founded 50 years previously by the powerful Saxon Earl Leofric, who is now most famous for his lady, Godiva. Lichfield, however, remained a cathedral alongside Coventry, so one bishop with two cathedrals, much like Bath and Wells.
You enjoy your work, don't you?
Bits of it, yeah.
The violent bits.
So, where did this cathedral go? Well, it didn't get bombed in World War II, that's for sure. Coventry was the fourth richest city in medieval England. Unusually, it was split into only two parishes, representing the cathedral prior's holdings and those of the Earl of Coventry. It had extensive city walls and 12 fortified gates, only two of which survive, but many were only demolished at the end of the 18th century, such as the Great Spon Gate. And Spon Street is a good place to start to discover medieval Coventry. Spon Street, formerly the main road to Birmingham, which then went on to Shrewsbury and Chester, starts well outside the city with this ancient crossing over the River Sherborne, which is very often full of discarded shopping trolleys, but it's still much cleaner than it probably ever used to be. Immediately after crossing the bridge, you come across the ruins of a building that was once a chapel, dedicated by the weaver's trade to the travelling saints, the pilgrim James and the piggyback giant Christopher. Eventually, this street becomes Coventry's most concentrated collection of timber vernacular. But first, we have to cross the Ring Road. God, that is a bloody huge IKEA. So this was originally all one street, Spon Street, until the Ring Road came and cut it in half. So we have to go down this. Oof. Not a good start, is it, to medieval Spon Street? A load of pomo bollocks. Right, well, here we go. This is a 15th century so-called Wealden House, and it's called that because it has these ground floor hall bays, which were only restored to the building in the late 1960s and 70s. This next building here, three stories, very impressive, was one of a few buildings brought all the way from Much Park Street on the other side of the city, and many medieval features have been restored to it. These next few along, these are in situ, Spon Street. They're all timber framed, including the one on left there. Inside the last one, the roof timbers were dendrodated to 1395. Back over to the south side, we have the old Wimble pub. Can't go in, I'm driving. All hidden by render, but another medieval timber frame building. That's a big Georgian building and upwards Upper Spon Street, and then there, the Green Dragon Inn, also brought from Much Park Street. And there's that massive IKEA again. Funnily enough, though, a lot of these buildings, when they were moved, did kind of look like IKEA flat packs, and they only kept the timbers, not the infills in between when they moved them. Now, these are a couple of post-1900 properties. Nice skip, though.
There's the electricity substation behind us to the left. This, though, with the square framing, is an early 18th century building brought from Upper Spond Street. Oh, I've had a bit of a break in there. And the magnificent Tudor house with its coved bays. Very, very nice roof inside it as well. And a few more properties on the end. Wealden houses. And a two-bay deep property that was bought from Much Park Street. Mind these things, just across the road here. What are you looking at, mate? Alright, this of course was the site of the Great Spon Gate as we approach the city wall, and behind it, the extremely impressive and much forgotten about Church of St. John the Baptist. The Church of St. John the Baptist was usually not built to serve a parish, but as a dedicated guild chapel, and eventually a collegiate church staffed by secular canons. It was founded by Queen Isabella of France, wife of King Edward II, as a chantry to her dearly departed husband, which is a bit bloody rich, really, because of course she cheated on him with Roger Mortimer, who probably had him killed in a quite painful manner.
It's poker!
As she held the manor of Charlesmoor to the south of the city, Queen Isabella made a number of investments in Coventry, and this was a major one of them. The current building, with its spectacularly light all-through clerestory and handsome perp tracery, dates to after 1393, when the guild chapel was upgraded into a full college of 9 priests, who would pray the divine office in the church daily. The church survived by the skin of its teeth to become a parish church in 1734 and to get restored by Gilbert Scott in 1858. The complex known as Bay Blake School behind it represents the residences of the canons who prayed in the church. But there's much more to medieval Coventry than just Spon Street. Let's go and meet some friars. Yeah, it's not the most glamorous location now, but this was the site of a community of Carmelites, the so-called White Friars, which was founded here in Coventry in 1342. Carmelites were a funny old lot. They traced their foundation back to the Old Testament prophet Elijah, who lived on Mount Carmel, so they were claiming to be older than Christianity, which is interesting. Their habits were originally striped, to represent the burns that the first such garment received when Elijah was riding in his fiery chariot. But everyone made fun of them, so they changed it to white in 1287. The bit of the Carmelite house that survives at Coventry is the east walk of the cloister, where the chapter house would have been. This here is the east end of their exceptionally large friary church, with the nave and all that under the Ring Road. And over here, you can see the inside of their cloister. I don't know how you actually get inside the cloister walk. The local museum own it, but the cloister vaulting is still there. And this bloody gate, Ring Road, really does obscure what a huge house this was. Shame, really. But there's this info board that gives you an idea and saves me doing a drawing of it, so there's that. But that was the second friary to be founded in Coventry. It was a large enough city to have an earlier one, run by the Franciscan order. In typical English fashion, like Richmond and King's Lynn, all that's left is the Grey Friars Church's crossing tower. The nave and Friars Choir, not to mention all their cloisters and all the other stuff, are so built on for their plan to be effectively have been destroyed. And the steeple just stood on its own for about 300 years, until uniquely, in the 1830s, a new parish church was appended onto the west side of it. This was bombed out in 1941, and most of it now has been stripped away, revealing the original 14th century stonework. And if you're wondering why it's such a bloody mess around here, it's because at the time of the Google Earth survey, the site of this rather nice 1970s office block had just been cleared for the construction of this rather dominating swimming baths, which was fully pumping out the nostalgic chloramine vapours in early 2020 when I visited. Also just worth pointing out is the Hospital of St. John the Baptist at the north end of town. This was a small secular community that, as was normal for a medieval city, provided refuge for wayfarers and palliative care for the elderly. The current building is a chapel that was built in the mid-14th century, and in a very typical Reformation story, all its resources, including the chapel, were appropriated as a school at the end of the 1540s. God knows how you get the council to let you inside the bloody thing, but what's interesting is that it has the choir stalls taken from our friends at the Whitefriars, which is nice. Right now, over to the big guns. The first parish church of Coventry was probably Holy Trinity, adjacent to the lost Priory Cathedral. It was the parish church of the West, the Prior's half, of Coventry. And while it's most famous for its Last Judgment painting of the 1430s, the fact that it survives is doubly bucky, as it's painted on the west side of that most precarious of structures, a crossing tower, which, despite architectural efforts to prop it up, most notably the bizarre-looking eastern half-arches of the late 14th century nave arcades, the tower partly collapsed in 1666, unlucky for some, and rebuilt and reclad many times since. It is due to the strange condition of Coventry only having two parishes that the huge Holy Trinity is but a stone's throw away from an even bigger parish church. St Michael originated as a castle chapel, and it represented the Earl's half of Coventry. Its steeple, begun with the tower in the 1370s, and its octagonal lantern and spire in the 1430s and 40s, at 83 metres, made it the tallest parish church in England, until the spire of Louth, in deepest Lincolnshire, was completed in 1515. The tower has an awkward gap just to the north of it, and you can see from the earlier roofline that it was originally built against was a much narrower building, and it was subsequently built in the 1390s, to have the largest area of any English parish church. Unfortunately, as a lot of people will know, the interior of St Michael was utterly gutted in an air raid in November 1940. Remember, St Michael had only been a cathedral church for 22 years at this point. The complete obliteration of the interior of the building seems quite incredible, but it was down to a number of unfortunate factors. The arcades of St Michael, quite similar in design to those that survive at Holy Trinity, with their spandrel panelling, were extremely wide spans. The rotten timbers of the giant roof were replaced by iron girders in the 1880s, and this was the problem, because while the fire raged in the middle of this huge space, the iron expanded, buckled, and when the pier bases were weakened by the blaze, the whole thing basically pushed down all of the interior masonry. Now, medieval St Michael serves as a forecourt of sorts to the modern St Michael's Cathedral by Basil Spence. Modern indeed, as it eschews such Gothic fripperies as elevations. Probably not going to talk out long about it, really. G.G. Scott's original design, despite various concessions, was considered too backward and medieval-looking by the panel, and after the war, the floodgates were open to a plethora of wacky new designs, many of which proposed demolishing all of old St Michael save its spire, which would have really sucked. Anyway, we're here! Coventry's missing medieval cathedral lay just next to the modern one. As it was run by a monastic community, in 1539 the cathedral was seized during the dissolution of the monasteries by King Henry VIII, and what with Lichfield as its joint cathedral, and two thumping great church buildings next door to it, the city couldn't realistically consider buying it off the crown. In 1545, the cathedral priory was sold to a John Hales, who set about turning it into cold, hard cash. By the 1550s, most of the church would have been reduced to a huge pile of rubble on the site of its former crossing tower, a fate shared by many other urban monasteries at this time. The city corporation bought what was now little more than a rubble-hewn bit of land from the Hales estate in 1575, and started to lease parts of the former Coventry Cathedral priory site to its citizens for various uses. In the 17th century, the vicar of Holy Trinity Church acquired the freehold of the west front towers, converting the northwest one into a dwelling, which, despite later damage in the 19th century by its conversion into a bluecoat school, is the most significant part of the old cathedral that survives today, although it's rather tucked away behind a 19th century mock Tudor pub, which, surprise, surprise, is now a Wetherspoons. Although it used to be a Wimpy. The site of the nave behind, used in the 17th century for a family of butchers to keep hogs in, and subsequently as a garden, and then as an extension of Holy Trinity's graveyard, remained relatively undisturbed for subsequent excavation. Therefore, the west front is the best preserved part of the whole cathedral. You can see the site of the now disappeared south tower with its arch into the aisle, and the response of the nave arcades. So the point to make about Coventry's west front is that having towers outside of the aisles was unusually ambitious. The usual Gothic plan was to put towers over the end of aisles. The screen facade at Wells, and other examples such as Old St Paul's at London, are exceptions in building the towers outside, leading to a sort of hammerhead plan. Hence, with the benefit of extremely limited information, I've been able to make up this sectional facade of a two-towered front with spires because, well, can you imagine the cathedral not setting off the spire mania in Coventry? As for the interior, the excavation of the pier bases in the nave in 2000 revealed another unusual feature of this cathedral. The south arcade was 12th century Romanesque, as you would expect from a campaign that commenced shortly after the see moved here from Chester in 1102. However, the shape of the bases of the north arcade and the western bays indicate that they were of a century later. This piecemeal nave build would be unique for an English cathedral, but is seen in some great abbeys such as Selby and St Albans, and might have been due to the uncertainty of the site of the see disrupting the building programme. The site of the cathedral's east end is not as rich in evidence as the west end. It was irreversibly obscured by having houses built on it circa 1800, and we have no evidence for any of the pier bases past the crossing. However, one uniquely strange feature was discovered during the building of Spence's Cathedral in the 1950s, and can still be seen today.
Right, there's that bloody house, and there's the cathedral. Right, walk this way. Nice wheelie bins. This, of course, is stone from the priory, but doesn't actually represent part of the priory. It's just reused. Notice it's the same colour as the cathedral. Nice scarves, mate. Ooh, an ecclesiastical cone. Someone's worried about their people carrier. Right, Benedictine Abbey. Right, that's right. Ah, yes. Still here. There we go. And here we are. This is the end of the apse of the cathedral. What's odd is that it seems to be at late 14th century at the earliest, and not the Romanesque. Oh!
Oh, Christ! Yeah, that stayed in.
The earliest view of Coventry is from the Particular Description of England, 1588, by John Smith, which, despite its title, was compiled from visual sources both before and after 1588. It has the three famous spires that we know today, along with St John by the Spon Gate, accompanied by an extra tower. But I think this is not anything to do with our missing cathedral, but it's almost certainly the Tower of Whitefriars, as that tower is recorded as falling in 1572, nearly three decades after the cathedral began demolition. So, what would Coventry Cathedral Priory have looked like if it still loomed behind one of Coventry's Wetherspoons? Well, we can have a bash at the most spurious of hypothetical reconstructions, just to give you an idea.
Thank you. wish it had never been born!